Thank you very much, Dr. Günther Kelly. Our next speaker is Professor Monika Schwartz Friesel, who is a cognitive scientist. And I wonder, because I thought that only historians are cognitive scientists, but I see that also you are professor of general linguistics at the Technical University of Berlin, where she is the head of the Department of Language and Communication. Among her research topics are the manifestations of contemporary anti-Semitism, and she concentrates on the coverage of the Middle East in mass media and the persuasive power of hostile language use. She is the author and editor of several books, such as Language and Emotion, Contemporary Anti-Semitism in Mainstream Germany, and because she's a professor of linguistics, I will not dare to read in German the name of the publication, just in English, Contemporary Anti-Semitism in Mainstream Germany, edited with Yehuda Reinhardt and Eviatar Friesel, and most recently, The Language of Anti-Semitism in the 21st Century, edited with Yehuda Reinhardt. Most recent research projects focus on hate speech and contemporary anti-Semitism on the internet in cooperation with the Tauber Institute of Brandeis University in the United States and on conceptualizations of Islamic terrorism in the mass media. Professor Monika Schwartz-Friesel will speak now about anti-Semitism in the mainstream of German society, empirical findings. Professor Schwartz, please.
Thank you for your introduction. Dear organizers, ladies and gentlemen, it is widely believed and most commonly asserted that today's anti-Semitism is mainly or primarily a phenomenon of right-wing extremists. But this belief is an illusion. It is a well-kept, a well-defended, and a well-cherished illusion, but it is still an illusion, and I will present some empirical evidence which shows that we have a very aggressive anti-Semitism also in the mainstream or in the middle of the society. Now give me 10 seconds so I have to arrange my PowerPoint. Yes, I know. Thank you very much. Okay, so I have to just do the microphone this way. Okay, so let's start. We have dealt for the last 8 years or so with the following questions. First, what are the main mental and verbal characteristics of today's anti-Semitism? How are they articulated? How is hostility towards Jews verbally articulated in the 21st century? And which traditional, which classical stereotypes are still found in modern discourse? Have new stereotypes and maybe some argumentation patterns emerged and become normalized in the modern discourse? And of course, which role does the anti-Israeli slurs play? And here we come to the question whether all the years of remembering, of coping with the past, of dealing with the Holocaust, whether this has really led to a change, to a break in German society. And one very important question for us was to look at the mainstream society and whether the collective awareness which we have on the official level of our society, whether the collective awareness of how dangerous a discriminating rhetorics and hate speech can be, prevent the use and the articulation of such means and strategies in the middle of society. Now, our research group examines since 2004-2005 the verbal manifestations of contemporary anti-Semitism. And we have been documenting and analyzing all kinds of data on in contemporary discourse. both on Jews and Judaism and, of course, on Israel, because we will see this is very important. And we still analyze the data within the interdisciplinary framework of cognitive science. That is, we are combining reflections of historical research on Jew hatred with empirical corpus study and textual analysis. Whoops. And we concentrate on verbal manifestations because, first of all, they give us very, very important insights into the underlying mental representations of how modern anti-Semites think and feel about Jews. And on the other hand, it is very important always to think about the very important function of language in as far as it shapes and still determines conceptualization of Jews. So the verbal structures we have examined do not only construct conceptualizations of Jews, for instance, we will see as strange and evil creatures, but they also reproduce them all the time, and hence they are kept in the collective memory of the German society. Our working definition, first of all, conceptual anti-Semitism. Anti-Semitism for us is a hostile conceptualization of Jews, which is ultimately based on mental stereotypes. And many of those stereotypes, most of them, have a very long tradition, and they are passed through many generations, as I will show by my data. Now, conceptual anti-Semitism is a negative attitude towards Jews and Judaism, and it has, and this has been neglected by anti-Semitism research for a long time, it has a very, very strong affective component, a very strong emotional dimension. So conceptual anti-Semitism is seen as a belief system, it's a closed world system that very strongly determines the worldview of the people who believe in such stereotypes. And the basis of this mental model up to this day is a highly distorted picture of Jews as the evil others, which I will show with my data. One example, personally, I don't know any person from Israel or of Jewish belief, but I hate you for being so cruel to the poor Palestinians. This is an example sent to the Central Council of the Jews in Germany. So we find conceptualizations of Jews as the evil others and very parallel of Israel as the evil of the world. Oops. Example, you Jews are the biggest filth of mankind, to the Israeli embassy in Berlin. A punch in the face for you filthy Jews, we have a generic singular here. You are to blame for this world's misery. Israel is the filth of the world. The Jew is not a person, he's a product of decay. So we have this dimension of dehumanization, which is very old, which we find for almost 2,000 years. Hopefully, one day all Jews will have vanished from earth. We read that many times. Now, verbal anti-Semitism is a category of its own. Verbal anti-Semitism, to our definition, comprises all utterances that explicitly or implicitly, with or without intention, invoke anti-Semitic stereotypes, and they show certain patterns of anti-Semitic argumentation. And which data help us to understand this kind of verbal anti-Semitism? We work empirically, we work with corpus studies, because only corpus studies and not the opinion polls, which are highly artificial because you only have 3 to 5 items, give us authentic data. This is language production data, which is from natural discourses. And we have 3 types of corpus material: data from the internet, from the mass media, and emails and letters. And our data comprises approximately 50,000 texts from the internet, focusing on the mainstream, not on the right and on the left extremist side. We have approximately examined 40,000 texts from coverage of the Middle East conflict in Germany, also mainstream press. And a very important corpus is approximately 14,000 letters and emails sent between 2002 and 2012 to the Central Council of the Jews in Germany and to the Embassy of Israel in Berlin. And we have a comparative corpus. We examined in the last 2 or 3 years approximately 2,000 emails which were sent to the embassies of Israel in Vienna, Bern, The Hague, Madrid, Brussels, London, Dublin, Stockholm, to have a comparative basis to see whether the German emails are different from other European countries. Now, although our corpus study is done qualitatively, we are interested in the main attributes of anti-Semitism. It is interesting to have a look at least at one kind of statistics. And here you see, oh, I'm sorry, I see that it's in German, the letters and the emails according to the political tendency. And it was rather astonishing for us when we started, and here you see the end result. From all those thousands and thousands of emails, only 4% were sent from right extremists, and 65% were from the middle of society. So mainly academics, lawyers, doctors, professors, and so on. And to help you understand that there is hardly any difference between the texts of the academics and the right-wing extremists, I'll first show you some of the texts of the extremists so that you can see that looking at the semantics, there is hardly any difference. We found all classical stereotypes, murderers of little children, murderers of Christ, blood libel users, Shylocks, traitors, liars, disloyal parasites, greedy profiteers, sly conspirators, vengeful beneficiaries. Jews are commonly referred to as pigs, rats, microbes, plague boys, and so on. And they are demonized as brutes, devils, fiends, or monsters. And here's an example, it's to the Israeli embassy. Deicides, thieves, frauds, pack of Jews, chosen people. Or you are a guest in this country, so behave like one and stop your persistently impertinent agitation against the hosting peoples to the Central Council. Simply an inferior race, so we have racist conceptions. Why do you have to control the whole world with all might? So we have conspiracy theories. You aren't human beings, once again, dehumanizing. Jews, only you are to blame for this misery. You should not rob the land of other people. Here we have a stereotype, a new stereotype, is the ugly Israeli, ugly in a moral sense, the ugly Israeli who is a land predator, a land robber, and this is projected again back to all Jews. Jews are the evil of mankind and threaten world peace. This is one of the phrases we read most frequently. You are today's Nazis, a lot of Nazi comparisons, and the concept of the eternal Jew, that's just the way Jews have been for more than 2,000 years. We have a lot of threatening speech acts and so-called solutions, like perish, or we will kill you all one day, the gas chambers are waiting. May you suffer, may the Palestinians' blood came up in you. The Jewish question needs to be solved, so here clearly a reference to Hitler. One day you will finally be exterminated. The world prays for it. The world prays for it. That is a phrase we found also from left-wing extremists. Summing up the main characteristics of verbal anti-Semitism, both historical and actual anti-Semitism, first is exclusion. Can't Jews finally leave as Germans alone? So there is a separation between Germans and Jews in Germany. We have fixation by stereotypes. You Jews have been and are thieves, murderers, frauds, and land robbers. And always the eternal Jew. And we have a very strong component of devaluation. You are the most inferior thing God ever did to mankind, to the Israeli embassy. Now, what is part of more than 90% of all the letters and emails is a projection of stereotypes and a so-called reference shifting to Israel. Israel is conceptualized as a collective Jew, and Israel and Israelis are described as product of contagion, creature of dung, creature of plague, creature of filth, plague ulcer, criminal vermin, and so on. We have the transfer of solution plans from the Jews to the State of Israel, free the Middle East from the Jewish plague. I wish the Iran would throw the bomb on Israel. And now we are coming to the verbal anti-Semitism produced by writers from mainstream society, and I choose mainly emails from academics, that is, history teachers, teachers in general, and professors. Some lawyers as well. And they, most of them start their letters or emails with something like that: please do not take my letter as an attack or as an aggression or, for God forbid, as a kind of anti-Semitism, but as a piece of advice. And here you have a typical one from the left side. It's all of the people are giving their names and address. They are not anonymous emails. He calls himself a peace activist. He's, of course, not an anti-Semite. And then in his long letter he writes to the German Council of the Jews, not to the Israeli embassy: you learned well from Hitler and his Nazi regime. After all, what the Zionists do to the Palestinians nowadays is no better than what they repeatedly accuse the Germans of having committed to distract from your own atrocities. And here it's from an abiturientin, an 18-year-old high school student. She denies any kind of racism, and she's an active member of Amnesty International. And then she writes in her email, "Now I understand," referring to Israeli activities, "now I understand why Jews are said to be rotten, brutal, lying, greedy, and ruthless. And many of my classmates feel exactly the way I do." Now, what we have as a difference between right-wing and left-wing extremists and people from the mainstream of society is that they are much more often use so-called indirect speech acts. They express what they mean, for instance, by using questions. For instance, this one: is it possible, this is a professor who writes this, is it possible that the excessive violence in Israel, including the murder of innocent children, corresponds to the long tradition of your people? And he sent this to the Central Council in Germany. Correspondence to the long tradition of your people, I think I do not need to explicate the implicature. Or, do you have human feelings at all? Very, very often asked the German Jews. We find very, very much the stereotype that Jews, that German Jews are no Germans. Either they are seen as foreigners, or more often they are seen as Israelis. You are the last of people who have a right to give us advice. Attacks by right-wing extremists in Germany are regrettable, but your country is the last of all countries which has the right to denounce other countries. For your country, that is Israel, permanently commits state terrorism and doesn't even know anything about human rights, sent to the German Council of Jews by a lawyer. Blaming the Jews, Jews are responsible for the existence of anti-Semitism, we found very, very often produced by academics. Since the Central Council of Jews in Germany states an increase in the hate of Jews, this could also be due to the behavior of the people who complain. This is written by a doctor who is chef of a big clinic, a hospital in Germany. Jewish behavior is the main cause for anti-Semitism, and we have internal attributions for anti-Semitism. The Central Council of Jews should stop interfering because this kind of behavior creates anti-Semitism. And we have Jews as Holocaust profiteers. I do not read now all emails, but you see them behind my back. Common abuse of the Holocaust is articulated very often to the Central Council of the Jews. We even find the dehumanizing, I'm a German citizen and not an, it's always pronounced, not an anti-Semite, but creatures from Israel that call themselves human beings slaughter innocent children and women. You are human garbage. This is a teacher at a German high school in Munich. Are you human beings at all? And we very often have the confirmations. Anti-Semitism has a rightful cause, and it is based on facts. And you find very often that Jews generally are collectively responsible for the actions of the State of Israel. And I get annoyed at myself for having always believed that the Jewish people were persecuted wrongfully. The implicature is quite clear. There was a good cause to the Central Council. Or in the past, I did not understand what caused anti-Semitism, but your teaching examples, this is to the Central Council and not to the embassy, but your teaching examples concerning murderers and war criminals do explain this insanity. We have Israel as a collective Jew all the time, and we have the reversal of the offender-victim relationship by all kinds of Nazi comparisons. Here you see one that what is done in Israel is comparable to the Hitler regime, also sent to the Central Council. And we have all kinds of Nazi comparisons. The Israeli military uses methods of the SS, and so on. And we find the concept of the eternal Jew also articulated by academics. Do you understand where the evil, and he means the world evil, comes from? The world is fed up with the State of Israel's professional breeding of terrorists. He read that maybe in the Spiegel. Why have the Jews been persecuted for centuries? This is a question you have to ask yourself. And don't call me an anti-Semite, because it wouldn't be true. We have the marginalization of actual anti-Semitism. What is worse than anti-Jewish remarks is murdering or slaughtering innocent little children, etc. I feel ashamed of all Jews. And many of the academics call themselves humanistic, and they disqualify Jews, calling them immoral people. We Germans, we have learned from the past. We cling to humanistic values now and refuse any kind of racism. The Jews, however, obviously did not learn from the Holocaust. They are the most disgusting racists now and behave like Nazis. I can only hope for the Jews to come to their senses again, blah, 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 and acting like human beings. And now I come to the emotional dimension, which is very strong in all of the texts, and you see it that the people write as if their own lives were endangered. They are highly emotionalized, also the academic people, and they feel so much horror, and they are disgusted at the German Jews and at the Israeli people, and they are shocked, and they can't express their suffering for the poor mistreated Palestinians and so on. But, on the other hand, they are, quote, not concerned with contemporary anti-Semitism of only a few right-wing extremists. They are fed up, and this is all from academics, being constantly reminded of the Holocaust, and they call for an end of the excessive and unnecessary culture of remembrance in Germany. You have a total lack of empathy for Jews and for Israelis, which you can see here. This is lack of empathy for the culture of remembering. Stop wailing, you are so embarrassing. And you have a lack of empathy when it comes to victims in Israel. Maybe you will only learn if many, many Israeli children will die and their families will have to suffer. A teacher from a German high school. We find many irrational contradictions. A philanthropist who hates the Jews with every fiber of his being. Maybe he doesn't know what a philanthropist is, I don't know, but at least he's a doctor. I am not a racist, and I respect all people. I pray to God that no Jew will turn up in my family. And very often they legitimate their stereotypes by texts from the mass media, and the last debate on Augstein showed how very important the mass media are. Every day I have to read and hear about your disgusting, brutal and murderous actions in Israel. Just this morning I heard a report on the radio on how you mistreat and discriminate the non-Jewish members of Israeli society. And at the end of this letter he writes, but of course we Germans are not allowed to say just one thing against Israel. And he doesn't realize that this is a contradiction as well. Because the German mass media, no other country in the German mass media, we found out empirically, is as often and as harshly criticized as the State of Israel. There is no critique taboo. We have solutions from our humanists, a friendly advice. We cling to moral values of the Western world, Christian values of love, respect, and kindness. If you adapt to our values, you would gradually stop being hated. And the debate on the Brit Milah, on the circumcision, get rid of this atavistic behavior, reach the 21st century, and drop this barbarian ritual of molesting little children. Then you will be accepted in our Western civilization. This is from a doctor as well. And many, 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 many academics ask for the dissolvement of the state of Israel. I think at least 50% of the writers. Now, I'm coming to my last point. We examined the reactions to anti-Semitism in public discourse, and we focused here on the internet, and we focused on the coming out of the report which was done by the expert group for the Bundestag. And we found at least four or five strategies all the time frequently used. First of all, denial. I do not read all the examples, but you see what a lot of garbage. This is nonsense. There is no anti-Semitism in German society. Oh, I don't know anybody who would say something anti-Semitic, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Here you see the closed worldview. Then we have trivialization. Again, they pull any experts out of a hat and make very unspecific accusations against the German population. You have very commonly reinterpretation and reframing. Truths about Israel. I mean, this report was not about Israel, it was about anti-Semitism, but they reframe it and reinterpret it and call it critique on Israel. We have lots of wariness and aversion. They are fed up with hearing about the history of the Jews and about the Holocaust, and they don't want to hear anything about anti-Semitism. And many confirm and validate their anti-Semitic stereotypes by denying and trivializing anti-Semitism. Here is a very good example. If I present the facts which give evidence for an international Jewish Zionist conspiracy, then my mouth will be shut. And the last strategy, which we found very recently, was anti-Semitism as a joke for certain Germans. That was exactly the debate I just called upon. It was the debate on Jakob Augstein, who was rightfully put on the list by the Wiesenthal Center, because if you have a look at his text, you see classical patterns of anti-Semitic stereotypes and argumentation. But mainstream journalists made fun of it, because they didn't believe or they didn't want to see any kind of anti-Semitism. And so you had, on Kulturzeit, for instance, two times Tina Mendelssohn said, this can only be regarded as a joke. Or Martin Stein said, I want to get on that list too. And very, very often you heard from journalists or so-called experts, this is not serious, just laugh about it. I don't know what is laughable about anti-Semitism in mainstream Germany, but this is a strategy widespread on the internet as well. Now, my summary, you could see that patterns of stereotypes and feelings of aversion and hatred still prevail in spite of all the efforts to eliminate anti-Semitism and to erase the distorted picture of Jews. And we have many, many stereotypes reaching back to the Middle Ages, still found in discourse. And our empirical findings show that no real change actually happened according to the semantics of the three dimensions, that is exclusion, fixation, and devaluation. Jews are still broadly conceptualized as the others, as non-Germans, as vile and mean creatures, and they are perceived, and this picture is projected commonly to Israel, as a threat to mankind. As I just said, this is the most common kind of anti-Semitism referring to Israel, just calling it critique, but if you have a look at the text, They invoke all the classical stereotypes of anti-Semitism. So I can skip that. And I have shown that verbal abuse and hate speech does not only show within the texts of right-wing or left-wing extremists, but also in the middle of society. Also, you also find it with highly educated people. And in spite of the knowledge of the Holocaust, in spite of what the consequences of hate speech and the rhetoric of hate can be, we still find kinds of verbal anti-Semitism which we found in the 19th century and in the Nazi time. Of course, we have a difference, because due to political correctness and the bashing of open, of explicit anti-Semitism, mainstream writers use more implicit forms, indirect speech acts. And so the word Jew or Jews very often does not occur in those texts, but still they show anti-Semitic patterns of argumentation. As I said, they prefer more indirect speech acts, but this implicit verbal anti-Semitism is much more dangerous to our society, because most of the people do not want to see that there is a fierce anti-Semitism in those implicit forms. And they carry on, they keep the image, the distorted image of the eternal, of the hostile Jew, in society and in the collective mind of our society. The difference lies only in style. There we have a radical language use, but the semantics is practically the same. And for instance, you can see, that is the last point on the PowerPoint, that Nazi equations since the Gaza blockade tripled in the discourse of mainstream society. Now, my last point. So in contemporary discourse, you find all kinds of aggressive and hostile words and phrases, hostile to Jews, to Judaism, mainly to Israel, and they are quite alive, and the semantics actually hasn't changed very much over the centuries. And we could see with all our corpus studies that the verbal constructions of classical anti-Semitism are highly enduring and persistent in spite of all the historical adaptations to modern society. And this is one of the reasons why we reject the terms primary and secondary anti-Semitism. In our book, we say, please do not use these terms, because this gives a distorted picture. We do not have any secondary anti-Semitism. Anti-Semitism is always anti-Semitism, and that's it. Thank you very much.